is the woman who may blow the O J Simpson case wide open.
Jill Shively is the only witness who could place O J Simpson near the murder scene.
So I left my home at 10:45, and at the intersection of San Vicente and Bundy is where I almost collided with O J Simpson's Bronco.
Careful what you do before the lie. Lie becomes the truth.
Jill Shively's startling story was brought to life on the FX miniseries American Crime Story.
You saw him?
Yeah. Sunday night, about 10:45, just out of nowhere, a white vehicle just goes screeching up Bundy, and it was totally crazy. It ran right through the red, and me and this other car, we just swerved so that we wouldn't crash into it, and it honked at me like I did something wrong.
Move the damn car! Move it!
The driver was O.J. Simpson.
Viewers were left wondering. Did Jill Shively really cross paths with O.J. Simpson at 10:50 on June 12, 1994? Was selling her story to hard copy the only reason that she did not testify? Or is Jill Shively's story simply a lie? Using Jill Shively's statements, her grand jury testimony, the sworn testimony of other witnesses and indisputable facts, we will conclusively answer those questions beyond any doubt. In 1997, Jill Shively shared her story on The Charles Grodin Show.
I want to correct you on your time. You had said 10:45.
Yes.
It was 10:50 I saw OJ.
And what, tell us about that Sunday night. Where were you? You were coming from your home?
I was coming from my home. I had dropped my daughter off at my mother's. And I'd had the flu all day, and I was hungry, and I thought at the time this market, Westward Ho, closed at 11. So I left my home at 10:45. And at the intersection of San Vicente and Bundy is where I almost collided with O.J. Simpson's Bronco.
Mm-hmm. And when you first almost had the collision, the cars all stopped. There was another car involved as well, right, Jill?
There was a third car going west on San Vicente. And it also stopped to avoid being hit by O.J. Simpson's car, which had gone up into the median.
Mm-hmm. So the Bronco went up on the median and stopped?
It had to stop because it was blocked by the other car. And then they jostled with moving each other's car out of the way so O.J.'s car could go. And at that time, his lights were off, and I recognized him. I told Marsha Clark I thought it was Marcus Allen, but then I realized it was O.J. Simpson because I recognized his voice yelling at the car. And he had also given me this look like, you know, what are you doing here?
Testifying before the grand jury considering charges against O.J. Simpson, Jill Shively explains why she is so certain about the time of the alleged incident.
Can you tell us how you can be so specific as to the time that all of these events occurred?
Yes, I can. I was trying to get to a market, which would have taken me about 5 minutes to get there, and I thought that it closed at 11. I had 15 minutes to get there and I want a salad bar and I had 15 minutes to get a salad bar, and so I knew that I had left at 10:45.
Did you, in fact, get to the store before 11 o'clock?
Yes, I did.
Do you recall approximately how much before 11 o'clock you got there?
When I got there, I had 8 minutes to get a salad bar by the clock in my car.
So, by the clock in your car, it was 10:52?
Right.
Did you drive straight to the store after these events occurred?
From there, I went to the store and pulled into the parking lot. And at the time I pulled into the parking lot, it was 8 minutes. I was going to run in. I got out of my car and I ran in. I was going to go into there and they were open, but their salad bar was down.
How long, if you know, do you think it took you from the point you left the intersection to get to the store?
A minute or two. A minute.
So you think you left that intersection at about 10:50?
Approximately, right.
So you left the intersection and Mr. Simpson sped up Bundy North on Bundy at about 10:50?
Right. I was aware of the time because I was trying to beat the clock.
Jill Shively is adamant that the alleged incident occurred at 10:50 p.m. What time did Kato Kalin hear the infamous three thumps?
Who did you call?
My friend Rachel.
And what time was it when you called her?
I called her at about 10:10, around there.
During that phone call, did something unusual occur?
Yeah, I heard a noise.
Now, how long had you been talking to your friend Rachel when you heard that noise?
It was probably a half hour into the conversation.
Okay, so about 10:40 or so you heard a noise?
About that time.
Can you describe for us the noise you heard, Mr. Kalin?
It was, you know, in my room, it has this wall in it, so, like that.
For the record, the witness thumped on the witness stand with his fist.
And you hit the witness stand like three times or so. Was that three noises that you heard?
I believe it was three noises. It was thumping.
She asked him what time it was during the phone call. He said it was 10:30. And then I asked her how long after they had that exchange about it being 10:30 did he tell her he heard the thumps?
All right.
Different question.
Suggestions on the road?
I'd say about 10 minutes.
Somewhere around 10:40?
Mm-hmm.
Is that yes?
Cato heard the infamous three thumps at 10:40 p.m. His friend Rachel, who he was speaking to at the time of the thumps, corroborates Cato's testimony. Furthermore, Cato's phone records confirm that he and Rachel were speaking with each other at 10:40 p.m. on June 12, 1994. The drive from O.J. Simpson's rocking a mistate to Nicole Simpson's condo on Bundy Drive takes 7 minutes. Therefore, if O.J. Simpson was the source of the infamous three thumps, in order to be involved in the incident Shively claims to have experienced at 10:50 p.m. he must have drove to the intersection of Bundy and San Vicente immediately after making the infamous three thumps. How does Jill Shively's story mesh with the testimony of limo driver Alan Park?
All right, you indicated before we broke that you called your boss's pager. And that was at about 10:43.
Yes.
And after you called your boss's pager, what did you do?
Well, after I paged him, like I said, I got back out of the car.
Now, do you see on the phone bill in front of you, sir? A call at 10:52 and 17 seconds.
Yes, I do.
All right, now as you were seated in the limousine speaking to your boss, did you say something to your boss?
Yeah, I told him that I thought nobody was home.
Okay, what'd your boss tell you?
Well, first he told me, he said OJ's usually running a little late, so hang out until about 11:15. If he's not there by then, go ahead and come on home.
And this 6-foot-200-pound African American person in all dark clothing, was this person moving quickly or slowly?
Not quickly, not slowly. A good pace walk, it seemed to be.
And moving in what direction, sir?
Into the house or towards the house.
And when you saw that person, did that person walk into the entrance?
Yes.
After that person walked into the entrance, what did you do?
I then proceeded to, I was still talking to Dale at the same time. I said, somebody's here. He said, fine, finish the job, take him to the airport, and I'll see you tomorrow or whatever. I hung up the phone.
How long after you saw the 6-foot-200-pound person in all dark clothing go into the house, did you continue to talk to Dale St. John?
Oh, it was just anywhere between 10 to 30 seconds. It wasn't very long.
So on the phone bill in front of you, sir, and that last call where it indicates 10:52 and 17 seconds, does it indicate how long the phone call was for, the duration of the call?
Yes, 2 minutes and 55 seconds.
Okay, and does that comport with your memory of the length of the phone call?
Yes.
Okay. So you would have hung up with him at 10:55 and 12 seconds?
Yes.
And it was within the last 10 to 30 seconds of that call at 10:50, of ending that call at 10:55, that you saw this 6 foot, 200 pound person go into the entrance?
Yes.
Limo driver Alan Park's cellular phone records clearly establish that he first saw O.J. Simpson at 10:55 p.m. The drive from the intersection of Bundy and San Vicente to O.J. Simpson's Rockingham estate takes 5 minutes. We know that O.J. and Alan Park departed Rockingham for Los Angeles International Airport at approximately 11 p.m. Dr. Henry Lee and Dr. Michael Barden both testified that the killer or killers of Ron Goldman and Nicole Simpson would have been covered in blood. A total of only 1/8 of one drop of blood was recovered from O.J. Simpson's Bronco. If Jill Shively saw O.J. Simpson at Bundy and San Vicente at 10:50 p.m., in less than 5 minutes, how could O.J. Simpson get cleaned up? Clean his home of any dirt, blood and other residue which he certainly would have had on his person from the murder scene. Shower without leaving any blood in the pipes of the plumbing system at his home. Be cheerful and affable when he and Alan Park depart for LAX at 11 p.m. Speaking with Charles Grodin in 1997, Jill Shively adds details which, if true, will make her story bulletproof.
I thought he was drunk at that time, and I looked at the license plate number and I said, well, it was either 3CWZ788 or 3CZW788, and I had turned it in the next morning reporting him as a drunk driver.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, I did.
Without knowing anything about the murders?
I knew nothing at 7 a.m. in the morning. I had to be at work at 6. I knew nothing about the murders. I knew nothing what was going on.
And you there's a record of you turning in that license plate the next morning?
They have a report. They have a police report. They have my police report on file.
How do these comments compare with her sworn testimony to the Simpson grand jury?
Now, concerning the matter before, the matter to which you testified on June 21st, did you first contact the police concerning your knowledge of these events on June 14th?
Yes, I did.
And you were interviewed by the police on the following day, June the 15th?
I think, if I remember correctly, I was interviewed right away. I think it was the next day.
Jill Shively did not contact police until June 14th, and did not share her story with LAPD detectives until June 15th. Let's look at the events of June 12th, 13th, 14th and 15th to understand why this is critically important.
PM, did you receive a radio call from your dispatcher?
Yes, we did.
And after receiving that radio call, did you go somewhere?
Yes, I did.
Where'd you go?
360 Rockingham.
Okay, why did you go to 360 Rockingham?
We were requested by LAPD to pick up a vehicle.
Okay. And what time did you arrive at 360 North Rockingham?
Approximately 3:30. Okay.
And were you directed toward a certain vehicle or to a certain vehicle?
Yes, I was.
And what vehicle is that?
Ford Bronco.
Okay. The Ford Bronco that's been on...
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Simpson's Ford Bronco?
Yes, sir.
And did you tow that vehicle?
Yes, sir, I did.
Okay. What time, sir, did you leave Rockingham with the Bronco?
Approximately 3:40.
Okay. Where?
Yes, I did. Where'd you go?
Simpson and a four-wheel drive Ford Bronco registered to Hertz Rent-A-Car, the company Simpson has pitched for years in television commercials.
They couldn't find it in the Bronco.
In his Bronco. And
police are focusing on a car believed to have been driven by Simpson the night of the murders. Yesterday, police removed carpeting from the driver's side. It's being examined for blood, but police aren't commenting.
The Bronco was not towed away from the street outside of O.J. Simpson's estate until 3:40 p.m. on June 13th. The footage of the Bronco being towed was featured repeatedly on every newscast in America the evening of June 13th and throughout the week, with the license plate number clearly visible. Remember, Jill Shively said this to Charles Grodin.
I knew nothing at 7 a.m. in the morning. I had to be at work at 6. I knew nothing about the murders.
The following takes place between 6 a.m. and 2 p.m.
Jill Shively works first shift. Her hours were 6 a.m. to 2 p.m. Might Jill Shively been among the gawkers outside O.J. Simpson's home? As you can see, the day after the murders, crowds were already flocking to O.J. Simpson's estate. Jill Shively would have had enough time to make it to Rockingham after her shift ended at 2 p.m. and before the Bronco was towed at 3:40 p.m. We know that Jill Shively, or her doppelganger, was among the gawkers outside O.J. Simpson's home on June 17, 1994.
Well, I find that astonishing. You actually made a report and reported that license of that van as a drunk driver at 7 a.m. the following morning before really it was announced at all that these murders had taken place. Is that right?
That's right. And Mike Fleeman of Associated Press had done a story, and he even said then, yeah, she turned this stuff in before it was known about the murders.
A thorough search of the Associated Press archives, LexisNexis, and ProQuest newsstand did not find any articles written by Michael Fleeman or with the generic Associated Press byline that matched Jill Shively's description. However, it did turn up this article about Jill Shively written by Michael Fleeman. Jill Shively apparently made false accusations against actor Brian Patrick Clarke in 1995. In her book, entitled Without a Doubt, Marcia Clarke wrote about an incident of fraud committed by Jill Shively.
There was no reason to believe that I had just presented the grand jury with a flat-out lie. But I had. On my desk was a fax from a television actor named Brian Patrick Clarke. Normally, you take the imprecations of a disgruntled business partner with a grain of salt. But Clarke's story had a paper trail to back it up. According to Clarke, Jill had presented herself to him as a screenwriter and asked him to read a script she had purportedly written. She'd said a production company was about to buy it for $250,000, and she wanted Clarke to star in it. Before this bonanza arrived, though, Jill allegedly managed to borrow $6,000 from Clarke. And guess what Clarke later discovered? The script wasn't Shively's. In fact, it was the screenplay for a film in pre-production titled My Life, which starred Michael Keaton and Nicole Kidman. Clarke filed a suit against Shively in small claims court and won a judgment of $2,000.
To add more perspective, Brian Patrick Clarke is a successful actor who had prominent roles in three of the most successful soap operas in history. Then he met Jill Shively. A June 28, 1994 article in the Los Angeles Times revealed the details of Jill Shively's scam. The movie, My Life, was critically acclaimed.
In all our lives, every moment counts. From the makers of Ghost comes the most extraordinary love story of the year. My Life, rated PG-13, at theaters now.
Most people have heard of Jill Shively's infamous interview with the television show, Hard Copy.
Tonight on Hard Copy, a world exclusive, a key witness in the case against O.J. Simpson breaks her silence.
I caught him in a lie.
Called before the grand jury, today she testifies about her strange encounter with O.J. on the night of the murders.
He looked crazy. Like a madman gone mad, insane.
In the case against OJ, it's the grand jury witness.
However, there is even more to this story. A June 28, 1994 Associated Press story revealed that, prior to selling her story to Hard Copy, Jill Shively attempted to sell her story to Inside Edition for $100,000. Charles Grodin proclaimed the following about Jill Shively.
Well, you know, it's astonishing to me that you reported that license plate at 7 a.m., and the police should have a record of that. It's also astonishing to me that if they really wanted to characterize you as someone who was out for money, that you've turned down, as you say, $100,000 to appear on other shows. You're appearing here for no payment at all.
Right.
So, you know, I've never met you, we've never talked, but, you know, you reek of the truth to me. That you saw him at 10:50, you reported his license plate at 7 a.m., and you've turned down all this money in the meantime. That says it for me. We've run to the end of this, Jill. I find you extremely credible.
Thank you.
As we have clearly shown, each of the points made by Charles Grodin about Jill Shively is provably false. Jill Shively's story of an incident with O.J. Simpson at 10:50 p.m. on June 12, 1994, is a complete and utter lie. Jill Shively has spent 20 years repeating her lie, and journalists have spent 20 years not fact-checking Jill Shively's story, which has enabled the lie to become the truth in the eyes of the public. But now you know the rest of the story, and should have no doubt that Jill Shively's story is nothing more than a lie.
Careful what you do before the lie becomes the truth.